baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad. Sad, baby, don't you be sad.
Hey there, my name is Jonathan Weiner, and welcome to this video where I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the new SPL PQ equalizer from Plugin Alliance. Before I want to give a couple of shout-outs. First of all, I'm going to be using a track called Sad Baby by a great artist named Michelle T. Thank you very much, Michelle, for letting us listen to your handiwork, and you should definitely check out the track Sad Baby when it's out on Spotify, Tidal, Apple Music, and all the places. Special shout out to Ariel Borajow. For those of you who don't know, I am a mastering engineer. I've been a mastering engineer for a while. Mastering engineers would be nothing without great mixing engineers, and Ariel Borajow is an amazing mixing engineer, and he mixed this track, and he makes my life easier, and he makes your life better. So thank you very much to Ariel. So let me just give a little bit of context and history here about why I'm psyched that Plugin Alliance is bringing the SPL EQ and making it more widely available. I've been a big fan of SPL products for many, many years, for a bunch of reasons. It all sort of rolls up into the idea of quality, and the quality of their analog EQ, compressor, the routing matrix, the Hermes that they offer, and some of the other tools are just spectacular for a couple of reasons. One is they design tools that are really a pleasure to use, a pleasure to navigate the interface, and whether it's the analog or in the case of the plugin that Plugin Alliance has brought forward, they've sort of carried that idea forward. And I'm gonna talk a little bit about what I really enjoy about using the interface of the SPL tools. But there's another aspect of this, which I think is meaningful, whether it's in the plugin or in the analog, but especially in the analog versions of these tools, which is that they use a very high voltage rail for the audio signal. They use 120 volts, which means we have an incredible amount of dynamic range. The analog devices have a noise floor down around minus 94 dBU, and they clip around plus 32 dBU, which is an insane amount of dynamic range. You cannot do better in the analog domain, and it means you have a ton of headroom. You get a ton of detail through the devices. The transients pass through just clearly and cleanly and beautifully. And detail, again, is just kind of everything for mastering engineers when we're trying to eke out that last little bit of goodness in the sound of something. So let me dive in a little bit and give you a little bit of context for the PQ equalizer. Before I start talking about the technical features and the sound, I want to talk a little bit about the user interface. There are three things about the UI that are unique and great. And the first thing may seem kind of pedestrian, but it's something I really appreciate. And this is both the hardware and in the software. And that is that the controls or the knobs are large. I really enjoy having something where I can easily see how much of a difference I'm making in the overall signal. And if you have very, very tiny controls, it gets harder to see in great detail what you're doing. You know, for mixing engineers, you might be making big changes to the individual sounds that make up a mix. For mastering engineers, it's really about finesse and nuance and little tiny sort of changes that amount to real differences that make a track sound better, but they're small changes. So if you have a large controller or a large knob and a gesture makes a small difference, that actually supports the activity of mastering really, really well. So that's thing number one. Thing number two, which I also really like about the user interface, is a feature that's called auto bypass. And if you turn that on, what it does is it will, at periodic intervals, automatically bypass and then re-engage the EQ. So you don't have to click a button to do A-B comparison. And A-B comparison is another thing that's really important to mastering engineers. When we're changing something, we want to make sure that we're actually making it sound better, not just making it sound different. So every step of the way, listening to the before and after is something that we do all the time. So you can see in the interface, I've engaged the auto bypass function, and you can see that the unit is turning off and on at regular intervals. I can change the interval from just under 2 seconds all the way out to about 10 seconds. So if you wanted to change less frequently, so you can listen through an entire phrase of a verse or a chorus or a musical phrase and then have a change, you can set it up that way. Or if you want just a quick hit so you can hear the difference that the EQ is making to the sense of sizzle in a drum kit or something like that, you can set it to a shorter interval. The third thing about the user interface that's fantastic is the way that we can change the scale of the controls. So you'll see at the very top of each one of these five fully parametric bands, we can change the scale from 1 dB steps, or half dB steps, if you will, which goes all the way out to plus 20 and minus 20, to quarter dB steps. And so that means each one of these clicks is a half of a dB. In other words, it's scaled to one half of the range of the control. This does a couple of things for us. It supports the idea of a little bit goes a long way and allows us to be finessed and nuanced in the changes. But it also means that we can make a big change. You know, the process for some people to sweep around, exaggerate the booster cut in an EQ band, sweep around and find the center frequency that you want, and then reduce the scale of the change that you're making to get it more in line with what you want. Well, you can do that with a click of a button. So I could crank this all the way open to 20 dB and then click the quarter scaling switch, if you will, and then suddenly that becomes a much subtler change. So I really enjoy that aspect, and this is something that was in the hardware and they've carried it forward to the plugin, and I think it translates really well to an in-the-box UI or in-the-box experience. So that just makes it a pleasure to use this tool. So I'm going to give you a sense of how this scaling feature is useful. I'm going to hit play. You're going to listen to the track. I'm going to exaggerate a boost in the low mid-range band. And then I'm going to change the scaling from the half dB steps down to the quarter gain, or a quarter of the impact.
Ooh, love, I've waited on you, love, too long, and too long, like the fuse, love. That's all that I do, love. I know it, I know it. Sad, baby, don't you be sad. Treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad. Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I'll make it all alright.
So you can see where I can very quickly go from this exaggerated sense of the part of the spectrum that I'm changing to something that's much more subtle and in proportion in the context of what you actually might do when you're mastering a track. So that's a really helpful feature, and you'll see that we have this control at the top of every single band in the EQ. Another feature of this particular equalizer is the ability to change from a constant Q to proportional Q setting. And this is a way of designing the way the filters work that can support a couple of different ways of working. So let's say, just for the sake of argument, that I wanted to add a little bit of low end overall to this track. I could turn on the band, stay in constant Q mode, boost a little, say around 190, about 100 hertz or so, pretty broadly. I'll dial up a Q of about 0.7 and add a dB's worth of gain. Now I'm in quarter Q mode, so I'll push this out to 4 dB and hit play, so you'll be able to hear that difference now.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad. Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I'll make it all alright.
So you can hear I'm getting a very broad lift right in the belly of the kick drum. It's bringing up the punch of the kick and the punch of the bass. It's even reaching up to the warmer part of the vocal. Listen to that one more time. I'll start with it off and then turn it on.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad. Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I'll make it.
And And remember, that's effectively 1 dB of change, but I think you can hear that pretty clearly. By the way, if you're listening on your laptop, you might want to listen in headphones, because laptops don't all, or phones don't always let you hear the low end at all, or very well at all. Anyway, but let's say I wanted to do something a little bit more specific. I wanted to dial in a little bit more of the focused mid part of the bass. If I were to increase the amplitude boost here with a constant Q EQ, it would maintain the same bandwidth and just lift that whole range, which probably ends up being too big a change. And so I would lift it, and then I'd probably want to narrow the bandwidth. Proportional Q does that all as a single gesture. So as the amplitude changes increase, whether it's a boost or a cut, the bandwidth narrows. So you can sort of dial in more specifically on the change that you're looking to make. You'll also see, if you look at the UI, that these boxes that are in white indicate the Q for the proportional Q compared to the Q for the constant Q. And they start really, really broad and get narrower as we go around to the left. So listen to what happens, and I'll exaggerate this again so you can hear this difference. Again, boosting in the low end. And I think you'll notice that a little bit of boost will give us that big broad change. But when I put it into proportional Q and increase even more, it doesn't pull up so much of the belly of the kick drum. It doesn't reach up so far into the body of the vocal, but it's going to give us a little bit more of that mid-bass boost.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad. Sigh, baby, don't you be sad. I'll make it all alright, baby, make it alright. You're all that matters to me.
I now have an 8 dB boost with a constant Q EQ, and that's still kind of held together because it wasn't creating this sort of broad, bloated overall sound, but was a much more focused effect in the region that I was trying to change. So this is the benefit of a proportional Q EQ as opposed to constant Q. Let me now change that from the prop Q back to constant Q so you can hear that difference in that way.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad.
Starting that again.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad.
Right, so you can hear a big difference there. It's the same amplitude boost, but the bandwidth has changed in the constant Q mode to be very, very broad. So let me just walk you through a little bit what I'm doing here with the PQ to address this particular track. There were a few things that I found myself wanting to address in the original mix. Let me turn off all these EQ filters, and I'm going to walk you through what each one of them is doing.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad.
So the first thing I'm going to address is a couple of cuts. The first one I'm going to look at is the very, very low end. I love the thump of the kick, I love the push of the bass, and I love the way the kick and the bass are moving together, but there's a little bit of extra heaviness in the very bottom. And as I experiment with this track, I'm going to try to pull a little bit of energy out from 30 hertz on down to liberate the kick and let it come alive and give it a little bit more definition. For those of you that may know me from other educational things that I've done, I teach mastering, I've been mastering for a long time. I'm not a huge fan of high-pass filters in mastering unless they're absolutely necessary. So instead of bringing in a filter, I'm just going to try to feather out a little bit of very low end. So let's see if you can hear the difference when I turn on this low band. I'm just pulling out a tiny, tiny little bit in the very, very bottom. I think what you'll notice is you lose a little bit of the heaviness and the mechanical bass, and you get a little bit more of musical bass.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad. Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I'll make it all alright, baby, make it alright. You're all that matters to me. Oh, all that matters to me.
So here in the mastering room, I absolutely can hear that change. I hope you can too. Again, if you're listening in cans, I bet you can feel that the bass gets a little bit more definition. That's just a half a dB change in the very low end. And that's with a very broad Q. I'm using a constant Q EQ because the broad change is what I'm after. It's effectively acting as a shelf. The next change I'm going to make is to see if I can get a little bit more of a vivid impression of the vocal. So I want it to stand out, be a little bit clearer. I'm going to pull forward a little bit of energy right around 1.6 kilohertz to bring up that presence range. That's kind of a right in the breadbasket of what we might call the presence region. You'll see that I'm making a bigger change here. It's something in the neighborhood of almost a dB with a fairly broad Q. Because it's a bigger change, I immediately lean towards wanting to use the prop Q. And so you see the prop Q is turned on here. So I'm going to switch that band on and off so you can hear the difference with no EQ and with that presence boost. And then I'll switch the prop Q off. And I think you'll hear that it's going to be affecting a much bigger range and the whole track gets a little bit harsh without the prop Q setting.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad. Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I'll make it all alright, baby, make it alright. You're all that matters to me. Oh, all that matters to me. You're all that matters to me. All that matters to me. Baby, you're the one. Eyes bright like the sun. A smile so sweet and warm. I've gotta show someone. When all is said and done, and all the shit I've done, still miss you when I'm gone. I need you in my arms. But all I fight is just pull us closer.
So hopefully you can hear that the boost with the proportional Q in is focused on the thing I was describing that I wanted a little bit more of. It's bringing a little bit more presence into the track. I get a little bit more of the sort of funky rhythm guitar that's happening. I'm getting a little bit more focus in the presence of the vocal. When I turn off the prop Q, it gets a little bit sloppy. It's just kind of broad, and I feel like the whole track gets a little bit noisy. Even with that, I do feel like I'm getting a little bit too much in just above the presence region, in that sort of 3K region, which tends to get just a tiny bit nasty. So I've pulled in a small cut here in the band just below. In this case, I'm going to let that be a little bit broader just to sort of tonally shape that upper mid-range down a little bit and maintain the focus, if you will, on the presence boost right around 1.6K. So I'm just feathering out a little bit above that.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad. Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I'll make it all alright, baby, make it alright.
By pulling out that little bit of energy there, I feel like I can hear into the track better. It lets the vocal relax a little bit and stand out from the support of the rest of the track. And the last EQ change that I'm going to make with the EQ for this track is to add just a little bit of top end. And this is one of the places where this EQ really excels. If you take a look at the settings, in prop Q mode, you can go all the way out to 24 kilohertz with a Q of 0.1. A Q of 0.1 is incredibly broad. You could think of that almost like a Baxandall filter or something that's like an air band. Really, really gentle, just gives you an overall lift starting way down low. It's probably reaching down to 1,000 hertz or 800 hertz or something like that. And when just gradually lifting all the way through the top. So let's see what that sounds like.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad. Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I'll make it all alright, baby, make it alright.
So you can hear that it's just lifting all of the presence and all of the top end. It's a little bit too broad for this track. What I want to do is narrow the bandwidth just enough so that I'm not reaching down below the sibilance region. I don't want the edgy top of the acoustic guitar to come up. I want the air over all of the track to come up. So I'm going to back off the bandwidth a little bit. I'm going to back down the center frequency from 24K down to about 16K and leave the amount of boost here. And then let's listen to that.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad. Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I'll make it all alright.
Just a little accent up in the air. It gives a little bit more definition. The hi-hat and the top end is kind of sketching out the edges of the stereo image. And so I'm just kind of giving that a little bit more width on the very top. Again, very subtle. So with these four EQ filters, now they should all amount to a change that flatters the track. So let me play it one more time, and I'll start with the EQ off. Actually, I'll turn the auto bypass on. So every 1.8 seconds, maybe I'll make it a little bit longer. You'll hear the EQ going off and on.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I know I treat you bad, yeah, I treated you bad. Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I'll make it all alright, baby, make it alright.
So there you have the PQ EQ itself. Of course, Plugin Alliance has their TMT way of implementing a little bit of analogness. I just made that word up, analogness. When they are modeling existing analog devices and bringing them into plugins, ensuring that there's a little bit of randomization and kind of what makes analog interesting in the digital domain. And then they have mid-side and filtering and a whole bunch of other flexibility that's not in the original tool that's also available. And I think that's something that we've come to expect when we're working in the box. So overall, I think this is a fantastic tool in my kit. And I'll be really happy to use my SPL when I'm sitting here in front of the hardware, and really happy to be using the plugin when I'm working with something that I need to be portable. It's a great compliment in my arsenal. Sounds fantastic. Thanks for watching, and I hope you enjoy it.
Sad, baby, don't you be sad. I'll make it all over.